instructive publication here. Number of stimulating observations have been made by all the speakers. I don't have time to discuss them in great detail. In fact, there is no need for that. But I certainly would like to touch upon one or two issues raised by, particularly by Professor Harugopal and Professor Narasimha Reddy Garu, and one or two by Sri Vittal Garu also. I've been working on these essays and ideas nearly for the last 40 years. So therefore, I'm really tired. Now, I don't want to go over the whole period, you know. What was the situation in 69, what happened in 73 and 80s, and what is the position now? So I'd like to say certainly a few words on where do we go from here. Disparities between different regions. Because the factors which explain the interstate disparities are the same. It should explain the disparities between different regions within a state, within larger states. Whether it is investment or governance, or that same problems. There is a general feeling that economic reforms means reduced role of the state and increased role of the market. That's true. But in what sense? The reduced role of the state you find basically in respect of investment, public investment, which is not desirable. Public investment has declined drastically as a proportion to GDP. We all know that. Which has directly affected the backward states and backward regions. Because according to the existing formula for distribution of resources, whether from the Planning Commission or Finance Commission, Sri Vittal Garu has been there, I have been there, we have seen that. In per capita terms, backward regions stand to gain from public resources more. And where does it come from? It comes from the rest of the country, and the richest states contribute more in per capita terms. The incidence of taxes is more per capita. So that is to say, there has been some kind of a redistribution of resources from the richer to poorer regions via the state, via public investment and public expenditure. So reduced role of the state after the economic reforms has definitely harmed the backward regions. Number one. But then the desirable thing is that the reduced state of role, role of the state in respect of licensing and controls, which only had led to a lot of corruption and discretion and all that, may have been a desirable thing, good thing to happen. But on the whole, this needs to be investigated, and I'm putting forward as an idea to be examined. It seems to me that in terms of economic impact on the society, the role of the state has increased in the post-economic period. Post-economic reform period, this is what we are seeing. The role of the state in terms of direct public investment, in terms of direct controls and licensing and all that has gone or reduced. But its facilitating role or stimulating role to private sector has increased enormously. The private investment that is coming within each state, for each region, from the rest of the country, or from abroad, the private investment has definitely increased. And in facilitating that, in directing that, the state has a very important role, has been playing a very important role. Every day we have been hearing of, for example, special economic zones. and acquisition of land, of course, for that, but to attract investment from within the country and from abroad. State has a very decisive role to play, has been playing that decisive role in establishing those zones, in sanctioning them, and also, since I am talking of the impact of this on economy, in scrapping them, as Goa did recently. So it has a veto power, enormous power in influencing private investment. It was not so earlier in the pre-economic reform period. So the role of the state in education, in the context of information technology and in the new era of globalization, we know the importance of education and new technologies. And there the ITs and higher education has an extremely important role to play. The state again has a very significant role in establishing ITs, in locating them, because we are talking of regional disparities in development. Where to locate an IIT, which medical colleges or universities have to be encouraged and located, where state has been playing a very important role. I have a feeling that the impact of the state on the economy, and therefore by derivation on economic disparities and all that, has increased enormously after economic reforms. Therefore, let us not minimize the importance of the state and the importance of politics, as Professor Haigopal mentioned, in decision making. The word politics of planning was first, I think, coined by Ashok Mehta, but before he became deputy chairman of the Planning Commission, earlier in the 50s only. And we discussed a great deal at that time in Delhi, I remember. Even at that time, no planner was naive enough to think that planning is a purely technical exercise. There is definite politics behind it. First of all, in setting broad agenda for planning. Well, after all, the planners have to do their exercises to fulfill certain socially set objectives by the politicians or by the elected representatives. That is how politics comes into the planning process in the first place. And secondly, perhaps to my mind more importantly, in the process of implementation or non-implementation. Planning Commission may make all kinds of recommendations, projections and all that, but there can be failures in implementation, there can be willful distortions because of politics. Therefore, politics very much come into the picture in decision making, having a bearing on backwardness and development. So if you view like that, in the post-economic period, when the role of the state has increased, its possible impact on the development of backward regions has also become more significant. In this country, I think the decentralization of decision-making power, political for development, today rests basically at two levels. First, central government, or the union government, if you want to be correct constitutionally, but no one says uses that. Second, the state level. Third, of course, in theory at the district level also, but not really decision-making power at the implementation level. Therefore, the three powerful persons in the country wielding power and horizontally coordinating various centers of power are the Prime Minister at the national level, a Chief Minister at the state level, and a Collector at the district level. also coordinates horizontally, but collector now is very much harassed person. He is under the, 24 hours harassment by the politicians and ministers and others. So I don't know whether he continues to be really a center of power. Then, theoretically, yes. But basically, at the political level, these are the two centers, center and the states. So decisions having a bearing on development, on backwardness, are taken basically at the two levels, center and the states. Now we are concerned at the state level, where you are talking of backward regions and backward states and all that. Within the framework of national decisions by the Planning Commission and Finance Commission and all that, at the state level, particularly in the context of economic reforms, it is extremely important that the decision-making process, in the decision-making process, the backward regions and the deprived sections have a dominant voice. Experience shows that in a heterogeneous state, particularly when the backward regions do not have majority political standing,